Welcome, everybody. Today, we are going to tell you how to boost the performance of your web applications. And I think that's why you're all here, right? And first off, to give you a better understanding of what's happening, I'm going to explain the technical aspects of WEM regarding performance. Well, we are continuously working on improving the performance of our platform, but still, WEM applications do not perform as expected in many cases. And what we see is that in almost every case, this is caused by filter expressions. So, to explain filter expressions to you on the technical standpoint, we're going to discuss the following topics. First, there's a database, of course, and a session. Then there's a partial evaluation of those filter expressions. And finally, there's a SQL translation of the filter expressions. And ideally, an entire filter expression can be translated to SQL, so that SQL can do the heavy load, and that has the best performance. Okay. Well, I suppose you all know that every WEM application has a database behind it. And when a user or a client logs in on the, or navigates to a WEM application in the browser, then for that user, a session is created. And that session, in that session, data is stored and will be kept there until the client will close the browser tab or window, or when the session expires. So what data is stored there? At first, it's the transient data. So it's all the data that is not part of a database list, right? And when a user, that client, makes changes to the data in the database, then those changes are first, stored in the session. So those changes are only visible for that user and not for nobody else. And then if in the flowchart that user executes a node that saves all database changes, then that session, that those changes are persisted to the database and removed from the session. So given this, you could understand that if the user executes a filter expression and there are no data changes present in the session, and ideally the filter expression can be translated to SQL as well, you know, that will yield good performance. But if there are some changes in the session or maybe a lot of changes in the session, then you run the risk of performance penalties on your filter expression. For instance, when you render a data grid that uses a filter expression and you have a page size for, let's say, 100 rows, ideally only 100 rows can be fetched from the database. If there are a lot of data changes, you know, in a bad situation, the entire table, and maybe also tables that are referenced and used in your filter expression, need to be fetched in their entirety. So that's why you run the risk of getting a worse performance. All right, so even before a filter expression is translated to SQL, there is a partial evaluation step that is carried out. And what does that mean? Well, that basically means that we cut an expression or a filter expression in the smallest bits possible. And if we have that, we inspect the all the expression parts and we run the following assessment. Is that expression part variant or invariant compared to the list we are filtering on? Okay. Does everybody know what that means? Or I'll explain it shortly. Well, if it's invariant, then the evaluation of that expression part will never change regardless of the row position of the list we are filtering on. So in other words, we can just replace, evaluate that expression part and replace it in the expression. And when it's variant, then the evaluation depends on the row position of the list we are filtering on. Another way to view this is that if you take a small part of an expression, and you can just see, are there any fields from the list we are filtering on used inside that expression part? And if that's the case, then it's variant. If it's not the case, it's invariant, and we can evaluate it, replace it in the expression, and in that way reduce the expression. So it can easily, it becomes more easily to translate to SQL. For this, I give you a small and quick example to illustrate this. Here is the data model. Maybe you can take a look. Can you read it? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Well, there are three database lists. It's a product, a shop, and a supplier. And the product has a supplier that that is referenced. And there is a city and a name in the supplier and the shop. And then please don't, now I'm going to show a large filter expression. Please don't read the entire thing because it's not of any added value. But just to illustrate, this is a filter expression. And believe me, it goes on like this for a long time. This is a real life example, but simplified. So it's a little bit more readable. And as you can see, the structure is, there are a lot of if, else, else if, then, else if, then, else if, then. Statements. If those conditions are invariant to the supplier we are filtering on, we are filtering on the supplier here, so that's the context. Then that if expression or the condition can be partially evaluated, and you know, on a logical, from a logical standpoint, the first if statement that evaluates the true is only of any concern for us, and the rest we just discard. So in this situation, hypothetically, only we are left with these few lines of the filter expression. Okay, and what does that say? That says a row ID of the supplier in the supplier of the products where the product type is candy. Well, this part, this is variant compared to the supplier list. So we cannot, simplify this any further. And there's an end. And that says the city of a supplier is the same as the city of a shop. But the supplier, it is the list we are iterating on. So that is invariant. But this one, you know, the shop, it's not a sub list or a nested list of the supplier or anything. So this one can be replaced with the city, with the current city of the shop. And that means that this entire expression can be translated to SQL. So you get good performance out of this. Show you some examples. Okay. Here there is a template rendered, and this is just the output. We are going to look into the template itself in the modeler in just a moment, but first I want to explain a little bit about what you see here, and also take you to the rendering process a little bit so you understand. A template is rendered just in this order. You know, the render engine. Oh, yeah, sure. Thanks. How do I zoom here? I am zooming. Ah. Is this readable for everybody? Is it better? Yeah? Also in the back?
Yes.
Okay, great. All right. Well, first the render engine starts rendering from the top to bottom. And over here, it encounters a label that renders the timestamp of the current time. And it's also in milliseconds. So you see it here. And after that, there is a data grid rendered, and it is wrapped inside a panel. You can see it here, but I collapse it to give you a good overview. And then it renders this data grid, and the render engine encounters another label with a timestamp. And then it calculates the timestamp current timestamp and renders it out, and then and so forth. So there are here four data grids. Maybe I can put them all in the one screen. No. Well, and those four data grids, they have two kinds of filter expressions in two forms. And those two forms also have two flavors, and that is that a condition of that is used in the filter expression can be translated to SQL, and the other condition cannot be translated to SQL. And for demonstration purposes, the output of these filter expressions is exactly the same. I'll show you here. Here you see some countries, Afghanistan, Algeria, Angola, and there are 10 pages. And on data grid 1B, over here, you see the same countries with the same number of pages. And another thing to note here is that here, if you see the timestamp when it started rendering this data grid, and you subtract it from this, you see that only 0.05 seconds are needed to render this data grid. And also execute the query, by the way, this is important. And if we go to the next timestamp and we rendered a data grid with the same result, but an incompatible SQL query, or a SQL expression, I should say, then it takes almost three seconds. And now it doesn't seem like much, and some may consider this as, okay, I'll accept this, fine. But there are only 240 countries, 43 actually. So this is a linear increase of performance penalty. So if you multiply your rows by 10 or 1,000, you see what's going to happen with this time as well. Then in the second one, there's a second form of a filter expression. There's also a difference in performance in the compatible and incompatible condition. Here you see it's, let's say, 0.1 seconds, 0.05 actually. And in the second one, the last one, it is 2.5 seconds. Right? Yeah. I expected this to be a little bit less, but if I do it again, I'm sure. If I refresh. 2 seconds, 2.5. Ah, same. Okay, and here. Oh no, this commerce. Geography. Examples. Okay, and here you see the template we just rendered by the runtime. And here is the first filter expression. I'm going to open it here. And the filter expression that was executed is as follows. We have an hash value of a city where the population of a city is greater than 1 million. And the country of a city is the same as the rarity of a country. So, and we are iterating over countries. So, as question? Yeah, sure. I don't think because the difference is that the country is a list. So this expression evaluates to a list. And here I want to have the row ID of the country we are iterating over. So there is a difference. And this, I'll open also the data model. So maybe that's a little bit easier to understand. The country, yeah, it's quite simple. There's only a name and a country code. And there's the city that has the country reference over there. I don't. I think there will be. Yeah. You can also do that, but this is a little bit better because we can interpret this expression better. Yes. You can analyze it better than just using the ID field. ID field is also a little bit for is there for legacy reasons. So, but yeah, and as you can see in the comment here, yeah. this one, this filter expression can be translated to one SQL query. So yeah, as we just saw, the performance is all right here. It's good. Oh, can I close it here? Okay, and then we go on to the next filter expression, and it's the same construct with the hash value, only here this condition is not SQL compatible. And what is this condition? It says the population of a city raised to the power of one is greater than 1 million. But that's nothing, you know, it's just multiplying it by one. We can see that, and we remove it in the partial evaluation step. This, you know, it's not very likely that you would write something like this. And so it's also difficult to cover all those edge cases, but this cannot be translated to SQL. And that's the reason why the performance was that's much different. Yeah? Yeah.
So what exactly do you mean when you say it cannot be evaluated into SQL? Because at the end of the day, that is what happens.
Yeah, okay. So the difference is that the other filter expression in its entirety can be translated to SQL, because SQL will understand every operator, aspect, function, and function that you have used in that expression. And here, SQL doesn't have a power function. So we cannot translate this to SQL. Yeah, that's here. You know, to execute this query, we have to do the following. First, we are iterating over countries, so we fetch all countries, right? And then for all countries, we are going to assess this query and execute it on SQL too. So this means that you get one query for all countries, and then one query for each country to evaluate this query. That means In this example, 244 queries instead of one. So that's the difference. So it's also I also put it in the comment. First, you.
Yeah. You cannot translate SQL. It means you have to take additional steps so that you can actually create the SQL.
Yeah.
That is needed to make work.
It cannot be translated into one SQL.
No. That's.
Yeah. So we are then. Fetching all the parts or the result sets that are needed to calculate the final result. Yeah? Any questions?
The optimal situation would be that you can have one or only a few SQL statements directly executed on the SQL server with a limited result set directly to this means that you have to retrieve all data and in memory do all kinds of calculations before you can actually render it out. And that's why we have many partial evaluation options to implement and to execute to make it all work as fast as it can. But there are certain statements that you can create in expressions just by typing a few things, which breaks SQL optimization and which will result into lower performance.
When will we get a button about saving
Check SQL or something like that.
Yeah. I'll come to that later, okay?
Basically saying to get the best out of it, you should go SQL.
Yeah, you're right. Right. You should. Or I'll come to that later. But you'll be pleased, I guess. I'm sure. The next query, it's over here. Yeah, we are countries, right? Yeah. We are iterating over the countries, but this is a different construct as the hash value construct. Here you say the row ID of a country in this expression. So the country of a city where the city type is a town. And this is another form which has, you just saw about the same performance as the hash value construct, that because the entire thing can be translated to SQL. This is a concept field in the database, and this this is just the ID of that concept. And that's one thing that's important to realize, that only the concept IDs, let me also open this one. Only the concept IDs, though, they exist in the database of a portal. So this is another query. You know, it says the same result. It essentially says the same, because we get the row ID of a country in the countries of all cities where the local name of that city type is town. But the difference here is that now we use metadata of a concept. And I just said that we only store concept IDs in the database. So if you use anything like a local name, a synonym, a description, what else do we have, concept properties, it will not perform. The thing that will happen in this variation of writing an expression is slightly different than the one we had before, where we had one query for all countries and then the query was executed for every country, this one. Here, first all countries are queried, and then all cities are queried. So this means two queries. And then from that result set, we can calculate the final result set, apply the filter, and render the data grid. So writing an expression in this way is almost every time always better than using the hash value construct. Okay, and now go back to the presentation. Okay, and then we come to the part of SQL compatibility. And you just ask, okay, how do we know what is compatible with SQL? What conditions can we translate to SQL and which we can't? Well, compatible are almost all operators you see over there. The multiplication, division, greater than, less than, greater than or equal, addition, subtraction. And again, be cautious when you use parent of and child of keywords, because that is metadata of the hierarchy of a concept. So we cannot translate it. And there's a subset of expressions of expression functions that we can translate to SQL. And that basically comes down to what does SQL support. Okay, what's not compatible are the functions and operators. Yeah. And like I just said, the concept metadata, and also be cautious with using concept queries, because they are hard to analyze and oftentimes cannot be partially evaluated. So it can result in a performance hit. So you just ask, how can we know what's SQL compatible and what's not? And we worked on that. We added it to our documentation. And you can go to this URL. It's just our documentation website, but we added a new page, SQL compatibility. And I'll just open it. To show you. it's working. No. Oh, yeah? Ah, yeah. Great. So here you see some pages with, let's open this one, with some functions, and on the right you see if it's compatible with SQL or not. Now we only have this page. We are working on adding this information also to every page of every function in the REM reference documentation, so it's even more accessible.
By the way, what you're looking at now is our new documentation site. We are still working on it to integrate it with every link in the modeler itself, in MyWEM, in PublicWEM.io, but it is already available. So what you're looking at now is a quick preview, insiders only, but we are working hard to get it complete, get it out there, and link it within Modeler. So it's available.
And the funny thing is, when I was preparing for today, I was going through all the functions we have, of course, to pile up this list, to compile this list. And well, the most common use cases and the most commonly used SQL functions we already support, but there are also some SQL functions that we don't support and we can easily support. So we are working on that as well to give support to, and hopefully make some of the filter expressions that are problematic perform better already by just doing that.
You state this documentation is available. Where can we find it?
It's here. Yeah? And finally, we're going to see if you paid attention. And everybody who didn't has to stay for drinks. open. Is it opening already here? Yeah, here it is. Yeah. Okay, here we see two sets of data grids. And as you can see, I want to get them both into the screen. Yes, over here. They yield the same result. So it's what's happening. You see here a little bit described. All shops of the suppliers that have products that are cheaper than 20K. The suppliers of shops, sorry. And here, there's another result set, and here you see all shops that have products that are cheaper than 20K. So first we're going to render the suppliers and then the shops. And for this, this one won't work then as well. So I'll go to it from here. One moment, please. Okay. Here we have the filter expression of the first data grid, and it says row ID of a supplier in the supplier of a product of all products of all shops, where the product price is less than 20K. And here there's a slight difference in the previous examples we saw, because here I used a, let me open the data model again. Here is a nested list product, so that's why I use the all keyword. Over here. So you get all products of the shops. Okay, so my question is, my first question, will this be translated to one SQL query or not? Hence, if you think it will, keep your hand down if you think it won't. Yeah, you, well, you don't know? Can also be an answer.
I think it does.
Yeah?
I think it does.
Okay, well, put up your hand then. yeah, you're correct. It does, it does. And the reason is that, this is just the form we saw earlier. And this condition, you know, it's SQL can understand this, and we can translate it to SQL. So this will be translated to one SQL query. Excuse me? Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you ask is the all keyword necessary, and in this case it is because you said it correctly. The product is a sublist or a nested list of a shop. And when we are just using references, you know, it's not necessary, but we give the feature of nesting lists in each other. And so in that, essentially, you get a parent relationship for free. But that also means that if you want to get all products, you need to get the all, you need to use the all keyword. So that is... No, there's no difference. It's the same. It's the same reference.
Okay.
Yeah, it's exactly the same. Only we present it in the UI like this. So that's all. Okay. And my next question here is, what will happen if this condition cannot be translated to SQL? What will happen then? I give you three options. It can be translated to one SQL query, or there will be all the suppliers will be fetched from the database, and then that filter will be executed on all the suppliers. That each takes one SQL query. Or lastly, all the suppliers are fetched, then all the products are fetched, and with those two result sets, we combined, we calculate the final result set in memory. So A, B, or C. Yeah, because we use the row ID in a basically a list expression, right? You understand, Rob? I see you yeah, frowning a little bit. Okay. Go on to the next one. And here we have the hash value construct. And you see again the all keyword here. So this one says hash value of all products where the price of a product is less than 20K and the reference to a supplier on the product points to the current supplier of the list we are iterating over. Can this be translated to one SQL query? Hence, if you think it can. Yeah? Yes, correct. It can. And it is because also it's the same condition, can be translated to SQL. And then, same question. This condition cannot be translated to SQL. What happens? There is one query executed to fetch all suppliers. And then one for all products, and the result set is combined and a final result set is executed, or first all suppliers are fetched and then the filter is executed on every supplier that is fetched to execute the final result. So So we saw about approximately 8 suppliers, so that means 9 queries or 2 queries. Hence for 2 queries? No. This will be 1 query on the database for every supplier. Because we use the hash value construct. That's the difference. And there is a transformation we could do, we could carry out to translate this to a row in of a list expression, but that's very, very difficult to achieve. So it's, yeah. This is the third one. Excuse me, is this correct? Oh, yeah. And here we have all the shops. We are iterating over the shops in this example. And we use the hash value construct, and we get all the products with a price less than 20K. Well, all the shops that have a product with a price less than 20K. Can this be translated to one SQL query? Becomes easy, right? Because it's the same condition, and yeah, this can be translated to one SQL query. And again, if this condition could not be translated to SQL, then what will happen? You think only 2 queries? Excuse me? Yeah. Please add the prices here, yeah.
So why isn't the hash value not affecting the query now?
Well, because the entire filter expression can be translated to SQL. So does it matter? So if that's the case, you know, it essentially doesn't matter if you use the row ID construct or the hash value. You know, because if everything can be interpreted, you know, we just generate one SQL query, and that's it has the same performance. But now, did I ask? Yeah, okay. Now the question is, if this one, this condition is not compatible with SQL, what does happen then? Are 2 queries executed, one for every shop and one for all products, or are first all shops queried, and then this expression is executed on every shop that is in the database. If for the last answer, please put up your hands. Yeah? Yeah, that's correct. Because of the hash value construct.
Why aren't you using the all statement now?
Because we are just iterating over a shop. Yeah, this is just...
you want to display all shops that have products and with a price over or under 2K.
And in the previous example, I put the product list here, but this is just a reference to... Am I right? No, that's not right.
I think in this case...
And this one is a little bit weird to read, the next one. And that is because we are using a nested list. You know, the previous example, it was a quite short filter expression. But a better way to write it is using this construct. And that looks funny, because you see first the row ID of a shop in, row ID of a shop. So you repeat that, of all products where the price of a product is less than 20K. And this is, this is essentially, you saw it in the render template in the runtime. It yields the same result. But if this condition was not SQL compatible, then we only need to execute 2 queries and calculate the final result in this form. Take a look. And I think we will also make this project available, so you can take a look after, because I can imagine it's, yeah, quite a lot to just all remember now. This is faster, because in a bad situation, only two queries are executed. So one for all shops and one for all products. Yes. Yeah.
And how can you compare, because in some cases you have just two queries, but then you have to do a lot of work in WEM.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah.
Always the case when you have to do a lot of SQL queries, then your performance goes down?
Yeah. Well, basically, it is good to reduce the number of SQL queries, because SQL is optimized to fetch data and do aggregation and joins of the different database lists you are using. So it's always better to let SQL do that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And another thing is that there's also latency that comes with it. You know, you have to make a connection to the database and read the data from the database, and that handshake takes time. Yeah, because you know, for security reasons, there's a handshake and there's a lot of stuff going on, but it just takes time, and it's good to always reduce the number of times of SQL commands. Yeah. All right.
So basically what you're saying is you're going to get rid of the hash value function.
Basically it comes down to that, yeah? And
damn, I used it so long.
It's easy enough to turn it around, but I never knew that this would be faster.
Yeah. And this is, if you know SQL, then this is more like how you would write it down in there. It's Just a different way of thinking, but the result on the screen is the same, but not in latency or performance. Well, and with this, I'm sure you will be able to boost the performance of all your WEM applications. And